Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Getting Right with Lincoln, Correcting Misconceptions About Our Greatest President by Edward Steers, Jr. Narrated by Jim Seybert. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. We learn from history that we do not learn from history. Georg Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel. Foreword. The study of Abraham Lincoln has inspired countless books and monographs. Despite an overwhelming amount of research and analysis, there remains contentious debate among scholars concerning major episodes in Lincoln's life. This timely volume takes aim at a multitude of myths and incomplete evidence that animate the Lincoln story. Edward Steers, Jr. was trained as a scientist, a scholar who studies facts that lead to valid conclusions based on all available evidence. Arguing with judicious skill and knowledge, Steers sets out to correct the historical record that is frequently marred by inadequate information and the lack of objective conclusions. In 9 chapters, Steers rectifies some of the most prominent misconceptions about Lincoln's life. Did he have a positive relationship with his father? Was Thomas Lincoln the poorest man that ever kept house? Or, in the larger context, was Abraham Lincoln's father a failure? These are relevant questions that help to reveal insight into Lincoln's formative and early years. The second chapter is an exploration of a seminal question that has haunted the Lincoln canon for decades. Who wrote the famous letter to Lydia Bixby? The letter originated in November of 1864 and was sent to a grieving mother in Massachusetts who was believed to have lost 5 sons on the field of battle in the Civil War. Steers lays out all the evidence and explains how some past studies have taken us badly off course. What is at stake here is more than the mere authorship of the most famous letter of sympathy ever written. What is at stake is the literary brilliance of Lincoln, the writer. Or does that prize go to Lincoln's masterful secretary, John Hay, the man some claim is the true author of this exceptional writing? The Bixby letter is so inspiring that it was used in the opening lines of the iconic movie Saving Private Ryan, when it was recited in full by Harv Presnell, portraying General George Marshall. Steers lays bare the unexpurgated historical record, applying the highest standards of research available. For example, in Chapter 7, titled The Ailing Lincoln, Steers takes aim at the popular Lincoln myth that the 16th president had Marfan syndrome. With the mind of a scholar and tools of a scientist, Steers explains why this theory is biased and wrong. Throughout the book, Steers tackles myth after myth, bringing judicious research and clarity to important topics. As a scholar, Steers has been chipping away at significant Lincoln facts for 4 decades. With more than a dozen books to his credit, he authored Lincoln Legends, Myths, Hoaxes, and Confabulations Associated with Our Greatest President in 2007. In the introduction to that book, Lincoln scholar Harold Holzer wrote, "Now Ed Steers, too, joins the ranks of Lincoln historians who have worked assiduously and successfully to separate fact from both fiction and folklore." Indeed, once again, as he has accomplished so many times in the past, Steers redirects our attention to seminal questions concerning Lincoln's life. Now, he permanently answers nagging questions with brilliant analysis and welcome clarity, using the full spectrum of evidence and facts. Joseph Guerrera, Lehigh Valley Heritage Museum, Allentown, Pennsylvania. Preface. Abraham Lincoln is one of those individuals whose person is so large that he has become surrounded by myth, myth that often replaces reality. It seems everyone wants to pin their tail on Abraham Lincoln's donkey. Some have espoused the theory that Lincoln was gay. those with multiple endocrine neoplasia 2B and Marfan syndrome, believe Lincoln suffered from these maladies, thereby giving greater acceptance to them. Lincoln's melancholia or depression suggests that chronic sufferers of depression might look to Lincoln to see that greatness is not immune from such sadness. It is all right to be gay, to suffer a serious cancer, or to be depressed. But Lincoln also suffered from constipation, insomnia, and occasional fits of anger. In the end, Lincoln could be all things to all people. To those attracted by the lure of revisionism, Lincoln was a racist. Even those who believe in Lincoln's greatness believe he preferred colonization to citizenship for blacks. To others, he was a stone-cold racist. He moved too slowly on emancipation, hated his father, and his marriage was made in hell. Had Lincoln not been assassinated, he would have died in office from his life-threatening diseases. It is a fact that Lincoln scholars are divided in their written descriptions of Lincoln as a child, a young man, and a president. They sometimes quarrel over his relationship with his father, his wife, and even his alleged lover. They differ over his assassination. He was killed under orders from the Pope, his own Secretary of War, Jefferson Davis, or all three. Sources are the determining factor in biographical history. Historians rely on primary documents, letters, diaries, recorded speeches, and first-hand accounts. Secondarily, they rely on the testimony and reminiscences of people who have some connection with their subject. Often, these connections are close, while in other instances they are separated by many years, relying on memory or on secondary sources, what the law refers to as hearsay. The further one gets from the subject in both time and place, the less reliable the testimony becomes. And yet, in many instances, it is our only source of information. In Lincoln's case, we have a collection of documents covering much of his life, known as the Collected Works of Abraham Lincoln, edited by Lincoln historian Roy P. Basler. We can rely on this collection in assessing Lincoln since it is generated by Lincoln. Second, we have several primary documents accumulated in courthouses that deal with the everyday life of the Lincoln family that have been published in secondary sources. Third, we have an excellent study titled Recollected Words of Abraham Lincoln, edited and evaluated as to both accuracy and reliability by two respected historians, Don E. Fehrenbacher and his wife, Virginia Fehrenbacher. Fourth, and perhaps most heavily relied on for understanding the intimate aspects of Lincoln, are the reminiscences of individuals who bear a range of relationships to the subject, from intimate to casual. This latter source is the work of Douglas L. Wilson and Rodney O. Davis, known as Herndon's informants. This work, however, is fraught with danger, and historians need to tread carefully when relying on it for source material. As Lincoln scholar James G. Randall reminds us, it is a collection of reminiscences based on dim and misty memory. Individuals rely on memory and their relationship to the subject, often decades after the fact, which can be seriously flawed. There is the temptation to embellish and to make one seem more important than is truthful. And last, we have the propensity of historians to want to tell an interesting story. Too often, many biographers wind up making a whole shirt out of a few buttons. This is understandable because historians are, after all, storytellers. Lincoln receives a telegram while visiting the War Department telegraph office. It tells of the death of a close friend. Lincoln's eyes fill with tears as he rises and makes his way from the building, clutching the telegram in his hand. He is so distraught at the news that he stumbles along the path leading to the White House, where he walks past a line of visitors, waving them away. "I am too deeply grieved to see anyone just now," he says as he slowly climbs the stairs to his office. It is a good story for which there is no reliable evidence. Still, it does fit Lincoln's character rather closely, and his behavior we can readily believe. We all know that wonderfully pleasant-sounding lyric attributed to Lincoln, "You can fool some of the people all of the time, and all of the people some of the time, but you can't fool all of the people all of the time." Only it appears that it was P.T. Barnum who coined the phrase, not Abraham Lincoln. As in most cases, it is not Lincoln who made such claims, but rather his admirers who are to blame. And who can blame them? For if Lincoln did not say it, he easily could have. Getting right with Lincoln is a reaction on the part of the author to what is seen as the wrong side of revisionist history. It is that attractive revisionist lure that some authors appear unable to resist. Lincoln may have hated his father, his marriage, been a hidden racist, and suffered from lethal diseases. But there is no solid evidence to support such claims. In fact, in every instance, the evidence refutes such claims, and yet they persist. This book is an attempt to provide the other side of the coin, and get right with Lincoln. 1. The Shiftless Father Myth. Like with so much of the Lincoln story, historians are divided on most events from his pre-presidential years. Many of Lincoln's biographers write sparingly of his years as a youth growing up in Kentucky and Indiana, leaving one with the impression they are unimportant to the overall story of Lincoln. Justifiably, Lincoln's presidency is the epic story of his life. But to understand Lincoln the president, it is essential to understand his formative years, including his environment. It is here where many historians fall short. Psychologists tell us that a child's brain develops more during the first few years of life than at any other time. The brain's growth during this early period is more rapid. 60% of a baby's energy goes into brain development. The remaining 40% must do for all the other vital organs combined, which shows just how important the brain is to a developing organism. By the third year, a healthy brain will have formed 1,000 trillion connections, a number beyond comprehension. It is in the temporal lobes, which regulate emotions and a person's senses, that early childhood conditions are critical. PET scans, or positron emission tomography, have shown that deprivation in infancy results in severe emotional and cognitive problems. Nature and nurture are critical to human development. While nurture, environment, influences a child's development, to be sure, genetics, nature, plays the dominant role. In most cases, genetics can override the effects of nurture, both positive and negative. While genetics may be dominant in determining character, nurture is the essential ingredient for development. What do we know of Lincoln's early years and of the father and mother who made the man who became our greatest president? The historical record of Abraham Lincoln's formative years has been like a metronome, swinging back and forth between a sometimes cruel, poverty-stricken childhood and one filled with mirth and glee, a young boyhood of youthful adventure and learning. In some interpretations, the youthful Lincoln is described as misery's child, who was subjected to cruelty and degeneracy by his father, while others say he had a joyous, happy boyhood and a home conducive to good morals. Cruel and degenerate, or joyous and happy? I suppose it is possible Lincoln experienced both, but with only dim and misty memories to rely on, what are we to believe? Is there a primary record we can turn to? Are there surviving examples to judge? Born on the 12th of February, 1809, Lincoln had very little to say about his youth. In fact, Lincoln had little to say about much of his life. His law partner of 21 years and close friend and early biographer William Herndon described Lincoln as the most shut-mouthed man he ever knew. And yet volumes have been written on Lincoln's musings, beliefs, and private thoughts in general. Much of these writings are drawn from the recollections of people who knew Lincoln, some intimately, some casually, and most recorded years after he died. It is interesting to see that the joyous boyhood of Lincoln can be ascribed to his two mothers, his birth mother, Nancy Hanks Lincoln, and Sarah Bush Johnston Lincoln, his stepmother, while the cruel and degenerate boyhood of Lincoln falls on the shoulders of the allegedly miscreant father, Thomas Lincoln. We are treated to this dichotomy and left to choose which life and which parent we prefer. The Lincoln story shows this dichotomy. Lincoln allegedly told Herndon, "All that I am or hope to be I get from my mother. God bless her." And follows the statement by saying that his mother was the illegitimate daughter of a nobleman. Lincoln then went on to say, "Did you ever notice that bastards are generally smarter, shrewder, and more intellectual than others?" Attributing his gifted qualities to both nurture, mother, and nature, genetics. Lincoln apparently felt that he inherited his intellectual qualities from the nobleman who took advantage of his grandmother, Lucy Hanks, passing his superior genes on to Lincoln by way of his mother, not his father. While Lincoln's birth mother and stepmother survive the acid pens of historians, his father does not. Few people have suffered more at the hands of historians than Thomas Lincoln. And this negative view was calculated from early on, shortly after Lincoln became president. The generally accepted characterization of Thomas Lincoln is that of a failure. Often perceived as lazy, slothful, and financially inept, his worst quality in the eyes of these historians is that of being a bad, even indifferent father. Such views are often constructed by cherry-picking the evidence and applying a selective view that discards the flesh and keeps the pits. Michael Burlingame champions many of the negative descriptions of Thomas Lincoln and his treatment of his young son Abraham. In his impressive two-volume biography of Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln, A Life, and in his earlier book, The Inner Life of Abraham Lincoln, Burlingame launches a revisionist assault across the broad spectrum of Lincoln's relationship with his father. Countering Burlingame's view is the more positive view of Thomas Lincoln that comes from Lewis A. Warren. Warren's writings on the subject are often referred to as the Warren School, while the negative view is represented by what may be called the Burlingame School. It is in the relationship between Thomas Lincoln and his son Abraham that historians focus their most severe criticism. In recent years, the Burlingame School appears to have won the battle. Like most everything associated with Abraham Lincoln, there is ample material on both sides of the ledger. The traditionalists support a rather positive view of Thomas Lincoln, while the revisionists support a more negative view of him. Current historians too often ignore Lewis A. Warren, who was the first to undertake a considerable amount of research into the early courthouse records in Kentucky. His book on Lincoln's parentage and childhood is absent from most modern Lincoln biographies. Likewise, William E. Barton's two books on Lincoln's paternity and on his lineage are also absent. This may well be due to their findings having been published in the first quarter of the 20th century. It is unfortunate because, while the research of these two scholars appeared a century ago, their findings have stood the test of time and should form the basis for any study on the Lincolns of Kentucky and Indiana. Warren published much of his findings in a little-known but extensive archive known as the Lincoln Kinsman, a series of 52 pamphlets covering decades of research in virtually every aspect of the Lincoln and Hanks families. Much of Warren's findings, mostly from courthouse records, cannot be found published in standard sources, and they are an essential resource for writing of Lincoln's early life. Burlingame writes that Lincoln was ashamed of his family background and the poverty he experienced as a child. William Herndon would agree. He wrote, "Lincoln rose from a lower depth than any of them, from a stagnant, putrid pool." One gets the sense that the more depraved Lincoln's childhood, the greater his success in overcoming the putrid pool and rising to the presidency. In fact, such a contrast is exactly what many historians point to in their praise of Lincoln. Not all historians agree with this dismal view of Lincoln's youth or the slothful father. Lewis A. Warren, who championed both Thomas Lincoln and Nancy Hanks Lincoln, wrote, "Thomas Lincoln has been the scapegoat for all who would make Lincoln a saint. Folklore and tradition have made him one of the most despised characters in American history." To Warren's detractors, Abraham Lincoln was a man who was born not with a silver spoon in his mouth, but one made from a thorny branch of the locust tree. It is true that Lincoln told his early biographer, John Locke Scripps, "It is a great piece of folly to attempt to make anything out of my early life. It can all be condensed into a single sentence, and that sentence you will find in Gray's Elegy, The Short and Simple Annals of the Poor." But this is a far cry from a stagnant, putrid pool and an abusive father. There is nothing in Lincoln's recorded or recollected words that suggest he came from such a lowly place. The hardscrabble life experienced by most families on the American frontier was commonplace. The Lincolns were no exception. One former neighbor said that Thomas Lincoln was the poorest man that ever kept house. This conclusion simply does not concur with the known facts. Thomas Lincoln was solvent for most of his life, and there was never a time when he did not own property or pay his bills. What we know about Thomas Lincoln's financial dealings comes primarily from the research of Lewis A. Warren and William E. Barton, two early 20th century historians who have disappeared from modern Lincoln biographies. This is a shame, for these two early scholars uncovered a significant number of primary documents in courthouse records that tell us a great deal about Thomas Lincoln's financial dealings and community life. They present facts, not conjecture. It turns out that Thomas owned 8 properties for which he paid cash. He appears on several tax rolls, never delinquent, owned several horses and livestock, successfully bid in at least 2 auctions, paying cash, and left behind a dozen examples of highly skilled cabinet work that can be found on display in museums and historical societies. Thomas Lincoln's early years are marked by success. On the death of his father, Abraham Lincoln, at the hands of Indians by ambush in 1786, Thomas, just 8 years old, moved with his widowed mother, Beersheba, or Bathsheba, and 2 other brothers, Mordecai and Josiah, and sisters Mary and Nancy, to the Beech Fork community in Washington County, Kentucky, approximately 50 miles east of their home on Long Run near Louisville. We believe she did this to be near her husband's wealthy cousin, Hananiah Lincoln, whom she could rely on for protection, both physical and financial. Although Abraham Lincoln, Thomas Lincoln's father, died in 1786, a record of his estate does not appear until 10 years later in 1796. In that tabulation, the following property is listed: 100 acres on Beech Fork, 400 acres on Floyd's Fork, also known as Long Run, 2 tracts of 1,000 acres each on the Kentucky River, and 2 tracts on the Green River of 800 acres and 1,134 acres, respectively. In all, the father of Thomas Lincoln, appears to have owned just over 5,500 acres of Kentucky land at the time of his death. Hardly an example of poverty. The rule of primogeniture, commonly practiced at the time, saw the estate of Thomas's father passed to the eldest son, Mordecai. While Mordecai inherited the land and assets of his father, it appears he shared a part of the inheritance with his two younger brothers, Thomas and Josiah. Lincoln historian William E. Barton concluded that Mordecai shared a part of the proceeds from his father's estate with his two younger brothers because both brothers paid cash to purchase farms shortly after the estate was settled. In 1797, Josiah bought a farm in the Beach Fork area, and in 1803, Thomas, now 25 years old, purchased the Mill Creek farm near Elizabethtown. It was just before the purchase of these two farms that Mordecai sold off several of his father's holdings. Barton concludes that Mordecai was the source of the money for the purchases, since neither Josiah nor Thomas had any income to speak of to pay cash for the two properties. Thomas Lincoln lived 36 of his first 44 years in Kentucky, from 1780 to 1816. During that period, he owned three farms and two lots in Elizabethtown. On one of the lots, he built a house for his new bride, Nancy Hanks. He was regularly listed on the tax rolls in both Washington County, Beach Fork, and Hardin County, Mill Creek, and records show that he paid his taxes on a timely basis in cash. During this period, he owned from one to three horses and various livestock, including cows and oxen. He attended at least two auctions, purchased several items, and paid cash in each instance. In 1795, he served in the Washington County Militia for a period of 30 days, from June through July, and in 1805, he served in Hardin County's 3rd Regiment of Militia and was elected ensign, second lieutenant, by his fellow militiamen, certainly a mark of respect. Between the years of 1803 and 1806, Thomas Lincoln served as a constable, which required him to post a bond. He also served on at least two juries and on a road-building committee. In 1814, while living at the Knob Creek property, Thomas was chosen by the court as an appraiser of a neighbor's estate. While none of this speaks to the relationship with his son, it does support a positive view of his financial status and his character, as well as his elevated status within the community. In 1803, Thomas Lincoln purchased his first farm in Hardin County, Kentucky. He paid £118 for the 238 acres on Mill Creek. 3 years later, in 1806, he returned to the Beach Fork community, where he married Nancy Hanks on June 10, 1806, in the home of her guardian, Richard Berry. The tax year for 1807 shows that Thomas purchased a lot in Elizabethtown, on which he built a cabin for his new bride, while retaining ownership of the Mill Creek farm. He purchased several kitchen items, including a dish, several spoons, a basin, and even a sword, paying $8.92 cash for the lot. It was in the Elizabethtown home that Thomas and Nancy's first child, Sarah, was born. The following year, Thomas moved his family to a new farm near Nolan Creek, known as the Sinking Spring Farm. This farm is now a National Historic Site administered by the National Park Service and contains the traditional Lincoln birth cabin. For this farm, Thomas Lincoln paid $200 in cash. By the time his son Abraham was born on February 12th, Thomas Lincoln owned the Mill Creek Farm, two lots in Elizabethtown, valued at $40 for tax purposes, and the Sinking Spring Farm. These properties represent a substantial holding for a 31-year-old man with a wife and two children. In 1814, he was listed 15th out of 89 property owners for tax purposes, placing him in the top fifth of property owners in the county. the homes appear to be standard for the period. From a modern perspective, we frequently equate log homes with poor circumstances, which is simply not the case. There are numerous records of Thomas Lincoln purchasing household goods, livestock, and farm implements, indicating a reasonably well-stocked home and farm. He even purchased a toy wagon at auction for his young son. These are hardly the actions of a slothful, harsh father who mistreated his child. Thomas Lincoln lost both of his Kentucky farms, not because he failed to pay for them, which he did, but because of Kentucky's faulty land titles and inaccurate land surveys. Thomas Lincoln bought the two farms, not knowing the sellers did not hold proper titles. He was not the only victim. The loss of farms throughout the region hit most of the landowners. Giving up his Knob Creek farm in 1816 and moving to Indiana, Thomas filed suit to recover his money as the innocent victim of a faulty title. He eventually won the suit, and the court ordered that he should recover his full purchase price. But having moved to Indiana, he never returned to Kentucky to collect his money. For the better part of his life, Thomas Lincoln was financially solvent and a respected member of the communities in which he lived. A full accounting of his financial transactions can be found in Lewis Warren's article in The Lincoln Kinsman. Lincoln scholar Michael Burlingame devotes a fair amount of verbiage to describing Lincoln's father in disparaging terms in his two-volume biography of Abraham Lincoln. He begins on focusing on Thomas Lincoln's carpentry skills, describing them as so rudimentary that people called him a rough and cheap carpenter who could only put doors, windows, and floors in log houses and do a tolerable job of joining. As an example, Burlingame writes, in 1807, Denton Gagan of Elizabethtown refused to pay Thomas for hewing timbers for his sawmill. Gagan claimed some timbers were too short, others too long. Gagan refused to pay Thomas Lincoln, and Lincoln filed suit against Gagan in magistrate's court on March 25, 1807. He won his claim. The court dismissed the case, and Gagan was ordered to pay Lincoln and the court costs. On review, it was decided that Lincoln fulfilled the contract in a workmanlike manner. When it comes to Thomas Lincoln's carpentry skills, Burlingame's assessment appears to miss the mark by quite a bit. There are at least 12 surviving examples of Thomas Lincoln's skill as a cabinet maker, 10 of which are on display in various museums. These pieces, several examined by the author, are well made and show a high level of craftsmanship, well beyond rough and cheap. The most elegant is a cherry wood fall front desk, which Thomas Lincoln made for Dr. Crook of Spencer County, Indiana. The desk now resides in the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum in Springfield, Illinois. Among the other pieces are a walnut mantel in the Officers' Club at Fort Knox, Kentucky, 5 corner cabinets, and a day bed. Thomas Lincoln's skill as a first-rate cabinet maker is obvious from these surviving examples. Perhaps the most telling description of Thomas Lincoln as a cabinet maker comes from his nearest neighbor in Indiana, near the town of Gentryville, John Romine. In an interview with William Herndon in September 1865, Romine told Herndon, Thomas Lincoln was a carpenter by trade, relied on it for a living, not on farming. It is true that late in life, Thomas Lincoln began to experience financial problems and turned to his now successful son for help. But this was at a time in his 60s when his health was failing after his move to Goose Nest Prairie, Illinois, in 1834. By age 60, he had lost the sight of one eye, and the second was deteriorating, leaving Thomas Lincoln nearly blind. He died in 1851 at the age of 73, in all likelihood from the effects of type 2 diabetes. While much of what we know about Thomas Lincoln's financial life comes from Warren and Barton, much of what we know about Thomas Lincoln's personal life comes from the research of William Herndon. Herndon interviewed several neighbors and associates of Lincoln from his early years in Kentucky, Indiana, and New Salem in preparation for writing his own biography of Lincoln. These interviews and letters are published in a single volume edited by Douglas L. Wilson and Rodney O. Davis. The chief witness concerning Thomas and Abraham Lincoln's early life for most researchers, including Herndon, is Dennis Hanks. Hanks was 10 years Lincoln's senior and lived with the Lincoln family in Indiana from 1818 to 1821, following the deaths of his adoptive parents. Dennis was the illegitimate son of Lincoln's great-aunt, Nancy Hanks, who was Nancy Hanks Lincoln's aunt and sister to Lucy Hanks, and Charles Friend. He was raised in the household of his aunt and uncle, Elizabeth and Thomas Sparrow. The Sparrows died from milk sickness in 1818, near the same time that Abraham Lincoln's mother died from the same disease. Dennis was 19 years old when he moved into the household of Thomas Lincoln. Abraham was 9. Dennis followed Thomas Lincoln when he moved to Illinois in 1830 and spent his later years living with the extended family of Thomas Lincoln at Goose Nest Prairie. He was killed when run down by a carriage in 1892 while returning from a celebration commemorating the passage of the 13th Amendment. While Dennis Hanks's close association with the Lincoln family makes him the best source of information on the Lincolns during these early years, it does not always make him the most reliable. The complications biographers face include Dennis's unreliability in certain specifics of his testimony. Known to embellish his role as a biographer of the Lincoln family and close friend of Abraham Lincoln, Dennis's statements have to be analyzed as anecdotes and, where possible, corroborated. An example of this is his attempt to legitimize the birth of Lincoln's mother, Nancy Hanks. The effort to disparage Lincoln by pointing out that his mother was a bastard was prevalent among his enemies, especially throughout the southern states during his presidency and after his death by many neo-Confederates. By the same token, some biographers attempted to show how special Lincoln became by contrasting his alleged poverty and white trash parents with his rising above them to the presidency. We now know from mitochondrial DNA analysis, or mtDNA, that Nancy Hanks was the daughter of Lucy Hanks, as historians believed. Dennis, in an apparent attempt to legitimize Lincoln's mother, consistently lied about her birth, claiming she was the legitimate daughter of Henry Sparrow and Lucy Hanks Sparrow. Lucy lived with Henry Sparrow for several years as his common-law wife before marrying him. Yet, Nancy Hanks, Lincoln's mother, was born years before Lucy moved in with Henry Sparrow. In an interview with William Herndon, Dennis Hanks stated, "Thomas, at the age of 25, was married to Nancy Sparrow, not Hanks, as stated in the biographies of the day. Nancy Sparrow, Abraham's mother, was the child of Henry Sparrow. Henry Sparrow's wife was Lucy Hanks, Abraham's grandmother. The stories going about, charging wrong or indecency prostitution in any of the aforementioned families is false, and got up by base political enemies and traitors to injure A. Lincoln's reputation, name, and fame."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.